Hello guys, welcome to another video in the series of coding. Today we have with us a problem that's called Russian doll envelopes. You are given a 2D array of integers envelopes where envelopes of I is equal to width and height of an envelope. One envelope can fit into another if and only if both width and height of one envelope are greater than the other envelope's width and height. So you have to return the maximum number of envelopes you can Russian doll, which is just put inside the other, and you cannot rotate an envelope. So for solving this question, it is the same concept as we had used in longest increasing subsequence. So in this question, what we have to do is we have to just find the longest increasing subsequence such that the elements are in increasing order. So for example, in this subsequence, you can see that 2 and then 3 and then 7 and then 101. This forms the longest increasing subsequence, and it is of length 4 because it has 4 elements. So all the elements are in increasing order, and in this particular example, the answer is 4. So we'll use the same concept which we have used here to solve the Russian doll problem. So for that, we'll just quickly look at the longest increasing subsequence problem, and that will help us to solve the Russian doll problem. So in this, what we had to do was we used a dynamic programming approach. So we declared a DP array, and initially we gave all values in the DP array as 1. Because minimum longest increasing subsequence you can form consisting of one element. So definitely even just one element is a subsequence that you can form. Now let's look at how to find the answer for the longest increasing subsequence. So what we do is we declare two for loops with changing I and j parameter. So the outermost for loop is having the variable I, and I is going to range from, for example, in this I is equal to 1, then I 2, I is equal to 2, I is equal to 3, I is equal to 4, and I is equal to 5. So I will range till one from 1 to the last element. So I is equal to 1 to 5. And j, the parameter j will always range from 0 to less than I. So j will be 0, and then j will be less than I always. So this will be the condition for the inner for loop. So this is the parameter j for the inner for loop. So let's go over this example once to try to understand. So in the first iteration, what's going to happen is I is equal to 1 and j is equal to 0. This is the first iteration. And now in this first iteration, we can see that 3 is greater than 1. That means a subsequence can be formed when consisting of two elements, 1 and 3, because 1 is less than 3. So now in this DP array, I can change the value to 2 here, because I have got two elements which are forming an increasing subsequence now. So since I have got two elements, I will change the value to 2. And now let's go forward to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, what will happen is I will become equal to 2. So I is equal to 2, and j will change. Now from where does j start? J starts from 0, and j will be less than I, means j will range from 0 till 1. Okay, so let's look at these iterations one by one. So when I is equal to 2 and j is equal to 0, in the first case, we can see that 1 is less than 6 or 6 is greater than 1. So this is again an increasing subsequence with two elements, 1 and 6. So again, we can change the value of 1 here to 2. So in the corresponding DP array, so we change the value and we get two elements now. Now let's go to the next iteration. For this I, the next iteration will be j equal to 1. So when j is equal to 1 and I is equal to 2, we see 6 and 3 again forming a increasing subsequence. So you see 3 is less than 6 is again forming a increasing subsequence. But you see, corresponding to the DP, corresponding to the value in the DP array, we can see that 2 is stored. Corresponding to j equal to 1, 2 is stored. That means 3 was already forming a increasing subsequence with another element. So in this case, 1 is less than 3 and 3 is less than 6. So we have a sequence of 3 elements forming the increasing subsequence condition. So now we can store the value 3 here corresponding to this particular index. We can store the value of 3 because we have found 3 elements, 1, 3 and 6 forming the increasing subsequence. So let's take more examples to help it become more and more clearer. So in the next iteration, what we see is I is equal to 3 and j will change. So j will change from 0 to less than I. So j will be 0, then j will be 1, and then j will be 2. So this is the inner for loop, and in the outer for loop, we will have the variable I. So let's see the first iteration. In the first iteration, I is equal to 3 and j is equal to 2. In this case, we have two elements, 1 and 4, forming the subsequence. So we can change the value of DP corresponding to the index I to 2. Okay, let's go over to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, we have j equal to 1 and I equal to 3. Then again, we have a subsequence. 3 is less than 4. So we have a subsequence formed. such that we definitely have at least two elements. But now corresponding to this index, corresponding to the index of j equal to 1 in the DP array, you see value 2 is stored. So since value 2 is stored, that means 3 was already forming a subsequence with another element of length 2. So 1 is less than 3 and 3 is less than 4. So again, we see we can form a subsequence of length 3. So in this DP array, I change the value to 3. And let me delete this and let me write it clearly. So this value becomes 3. Okay. Now let's go forward to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, what we can see is in the next iteration, j is equal to 2 and I is equal to 3. Now in this case, what you see is 4 is smaller than 6. So it is not forming an increasing subsequence. So we can just go over to the next iteration. So when we go over to the next iteration, we will reach I is equal to 4 and j will change from 0 to 3. So j is equal to 0, j is equal to 1, j is equal to 2 and j is equal to 3 corresponding to that indices. So let's see the first iteration, 9 and 1. So you see that 9 is greater than 1, so it can form an increasing subsequence. So we can change it because it will have a length of 2. So 1 is less than 9, we are having two elements in it, 1 and 9. So you can just change the value here corresponding to the index I. Now let's go over to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, we have j is equal to 1, I is equal to 4. So now you see 3 and 9 are the elements. So you see 3 is less than 9. This forms an increasing subsequence. But you see corresponding to that 3 in the DP array, we find a length of 2. That means 3 was already forming a subsequence of length 2. So 1, 3, 9 is a subsequence and it will be of length 3. So we can change the length here and we can just change the length to 3. So let's go over to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, what we can see is j is equal to 2, j is equal to 2 and I is equal to 4. So you see 6 is less than 9. This is again a subsequence, but corresponding to the value of in the DP array, we see 3. That means 6, the element 6 was already forming an increasing subsequence with 3 elements and that you can see 1, 3, 6, 9. So now we already had 1, 3, 6. To this, we added another element 9. Now we have an increasing subsequence of length 4. So you can change the length here to 4. Let's go over to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, we see j is equal to 3 and I is equal to 4. So in this case, we get the elements 4 and 9. So you see 4 is less than 9. Again, it's an increasing subsequence, but corresponding to 4, already 3 is stored. That means 4 was already forming a subsequence of length 3 that you can see 1, 3 and 4. So 1, 3, 4 was already a subsequence. And then to that, we added element 9. So now we are having an increasing subsequence of length 4, but already in the DP corresponding to the index I, value 4 is stored. So it's okay. So we can just go over to the next iteration because we already have a length 4 stored. So finally, the length of this iteration, length after all these iterations is just, 4. So we are going to have in this DP array, we are going to store at the corresponding index I, the value of 4. Now let's go over to the next iteration. So the last iteration corresponding to I equal to 5 and the value of j will range from 0 to 4. J is equal to 0, j is equal to 1, j is equal to 2, j is equal to 3 and then j is equal to 4. So let's quickly look at the iteration. So in this, we are having I is equal to 5 and j is equal to 0 as the first iteration. So let me erase it and let me try to draw it with a different color so that doesn't become messy. So I is equal to 5 and j is equal to 0. So you see, we have an increasing subsequence of two elements, 1 and 4. So we can just change the value here of the in the DP array. We can change the value here and we can make it 2. Now let's go over to the next iteration. So in the next iteration, we are having j equal to 1 and I equal to 5. So in this particular case, we are again having two elements, 3 and 4. So let me write the subsequence. So we are having 3 and 4. So 3 is less than 4. But 3 already was forming subsequence of length 2. So 1, 3, 4 is a subsequence. So now we have a subsequence of length 3. So we can change the value in the DP array. Now let's go over to the next element. So you see next elements is 6. When j is equal to 2 and I is equal to 5, next element is 6. Now 6 is greater than 4 because of which it will not form an increasing subsequence. So we can just go to the next iteration. In the next iteration, we have 4. 4 is equal to 4. 4 is not smaller than 4. 4 is not greater than 4. 4 is just equal to 4. So this will also not form an increasing subsequence. And we can go over to the next value. So in the next value, 9 and 4. 9 is again greater than 4. So it will not form an increasing subsequence. And we can just complete all the iteration. Finally, after all these iterations, value 3 will be stored here. Now let me write it with the same color. So you can see that value 3 is stored here. So in this particular case, what we see, this is the DP array that we have filled, and the maximum possible increasing subsequence we get of length 4. And you can see it, suppose 1369 is a subsequence of length 4, and another subsequence that we can see is 1349. So any of the subsequence you can take, and that is of length 4, and that will give the maximum length. So this was the logic for longest increasing subsequence. So that's how we can solve the question. Now we can use this logic to solve the Reschendahl envelope question. So let me quickly go over the logic of Reschendahl envelope question, which should become easy now, since we have solved the longest increasing subsequence question, because we are going to apply the same dynamic programming approach. So 5, 4, 6, 4, 6, 7, and 2, 3. These are the envelopes. Suppose they are given to us, we have to see how many envelopes we can encase maximum into another envelope. So what we are going to do is, so for solving this question, we have to first form a increasing subsequence. So you can use either width or height to sort this. So for example, if we are sorting by width, then what we are going to do is we will arrange the elements by width. You can see width is the first first elements. So if I arrange by width, the smallest width is 2, and then you have 5, 4. And then you can 6, both these envelopes are having width of 6. So I can just place them here. So now this becomes our envelopes vector after sorting it by width. You can even sort it by height, you will get the same answer. Now what we can do is we can apply the same concept. So we are going to make a DP array, and we are going to initially store our values as 1, because minimum one envelope, you can definitely just simply have one envelope encasing, and you can return that as the answer for minimum value. But you have to find the maximum number of envelopes that you can encase. So initially I'm just giving 1 in the DP array. Now what we are going to do is we are going to do the iterations. So how do we do the iterations? So we start from I equal to 1, and I is the outermost for loop and J is the innermost for loop. So just as we have seen in the previous example, now let's start the iteration. So we will see that now we have two parameters to compare, both width and height. So we'll compare both of them. So first we'll check 5 and 2. So width, whether width of the envelope is enough to encase it, encase a smaller envelope. 5 is greater than 2 is true. 4 is greater than 3 is true. So let me draw a diagram. Suppose this is the outermost envelope, which is having width 5 and height 4. And we are having the inner envelope. Inner envelope is having, let's say, width 2, and we are having height 3. So we can see that the smaller envelope is going to be encased inside the outer envelope properly. So what we are going to do is we are going to change the value of the DP array here to 2, because you are having one envelope encased into another. So that is why this is fine. Let's go over the next iteration. So in the next iteration, you are having I is equal to 2, and you are going inside the inner for loop. So J is equal to 0 and J is equal to 1. That will be 2 iterations. So let me write the DP array properly before that, and let's start the iteration. So let's see the first iteration. I is equal to 2 and J equal to 0. You see that 6 is greater than 2 and 4 is greater than 3. That means this is, suppose, the outer envelope, which is having 6, 4, and we are having an inner envelope, which is having width 2 and height 3. So we are going to encase the envelopes properly and form a Reschendahl envelope. So we can just change the length to 2, because you can have one envelope encased into another. So you can have 2 envelopes, finally, a sequence of 2 envelopes, and so hence I have changed the DP value to 2. Okay, let's go to the next iteration. In the next iteration, what we can see is we are having 5, 4 and 6, 4. Now you see 6 is greater than 5, but 4 is not greater than 4. So you see that this is not a Reschendahl envelope. So let's try to draw a diagram, because diagram makes things clearer. So suppose we are having this bigger envelope, which is having length 6, width 6 and height 4. We are having another envelope, which is having, let's say, width 5 and height 4. So this is the inner envelope and this is the outer envelope. Now you see it is not completely placed inside this, it is not completely encased inside this. That's why this is not a possible Reschendahl envelope. So let's go over to the next iteration. So the next iteration, we have I equal to 3 and J is going to range. So J is equal to 0, J is equal to 1 and J is equal to 2. So let's check for the outermost envelope. So 6, 7 and 2, 3. So what we see is 6 is greater than 2 and 7 is greater than 3. So you are going to form an encasing of 2 envelopes, and you can change the value in the DP array to 2. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to change the value in the corresponding DP array to 2 for the particular index. Now let's go over to the next iteration. In the next iteration, J is equal to 1 and I is equal to 3. So in this particular example that you can see, J is equal to 1 and I is equal to 3. you are having 5,4 and 6,7. Now you see 6 is greater than 5, that is true, and 7 is greater than 4, that is also true. Both the height and width are satisfying the condition. So you see you have this outer envelope which is having 6,7, and that is having another inner envelope which is having, let's say, 5,4. But inside 5,4 there is already a smaller envelope. How do we know that? Because in the DP array we are seeing a value of 2. That means it's already having a smaller envelope which is having length 2 and height 3, which we have seen previously. So we are already having an encasing of 2 envelopes. To that 2 envelopes we already add a outer we add a outer encasing of 6,7. So now we can change the value to 3. So we are having 3 envelopes. So this value stored in the DP array 2 plus 1 is 3. We are just adding this outer envelope to already encased inner envelope. So that's why this value becomes equal to 3. Okay, now let's go over to the next example. So this is the last iteration for this particular example. So I is equal to 3 and j is equal to 2. Now you see 6 and 6, the width are same. We don't want it to be same. We want the outer envelope's width to be greater than the inner envelope's width. So this is not a possible valid case of a Russian envelope. And we can just, finish all the iterations. So in this, finally, we can search the DPR and we are having a maximum value of 3. Hence, you can finally return 3. So let's, quickly start coding it. So let me just change it to C++ and let's start coding it. So what you're going to do is you're going to declare a DP, short for dynamic programming. And I'm going to declare this DP vector that is going to store the number of envelopes corresponding to each index. So I'm going to give it initially all the values as 1, and it's going to have the same size as the size of the envelopes. Now what we are going to do is we are going to run our for loop. So before doing that, we have to remember to sort it either by width or height. So let me just sort it, for example, by, width. So I'm just sorting by the first element. So it is very simple in C++. You have to just give the sort function and it's going to, automatically sort it. And that's it. So I've sorted it by width, by the first element. Now I'm going to declare my for loop. So outermost for loop, int I equal to 0, I less than envelopes dot size and I plus plus. And I'm going to also give my inner for loop. So my inner for loop will have the, suppose we'll have the variable j. So for int j equal to 0, j less than I, j plus plus. This is the inner for loop. Now for this inner for loop, what do I have to do is, I have to, inside this inner for loop, I have to check the condition. I have to check both the width and the height condition. So corresponding to each index, we had checked both the width as well as the height condition. That means width of the outer envelope should be greater than the width of the inner envelope. So we will give if envelopes of I 0, that gives the width of the outer envelope, if that is greater than the width of the inner envelope. So envelopes j 0. So if the width is greater, and also we will have to give another condition. We will have to check the height and envelopes of I 1. So this is the height of the outer envelope. If that is greater than the height of the inner envelope. So j and 1. Okay, so now these are the two conditions that I should give. I'll put an outermost bracket also. So both these conditions should be satisfied. And if both the conditions are satisfied, then only, in that case only, what we can do is we can change the value. So DP of I corresponding to the ith index, we can change the value. So it will be max of either the current value that is stored, as we had seen in the longest increasing subsequent example, either the current value or it should be DP of j plus 1. So already we have encasing of envelopes. To that we are adding the outermost envelope. So DP of j plus 1 or the current value which is stored. Whichever is max, we will store that current value. And that's it. And finally, we can just return the max element. So how do you find the max element? In C++, it is easy. So you can just give max element and it will find the max element for you. So you have to find the max element inside the DP array. So dp.begin to dp.end. And that's it. So I will run this and let's see if it is working. So there is a little bit error. So envelopes, I think I have given a little bit of mistake in envelopes. So it is, let me see where is the error. No member named envelopes in a normal iterator sort of envelopes dot begin. Okay, so I have given a dot here. It should be a comma. And I think it should be fine now. So let me run and see it again if it is fine. So there's still error and no member named DP. So let me see, have I made the same mistake? Yes, I should have given a comma there. And I think it should be fine now. Yes, so it's finished, and let me just submit and see if it's an accepted solution. So it's an accepted solution. Thank you for being patient.